inside tanks like this. The future of our planet's food security is kept frozen in time. Cryopreservation stores plant seeds and tissues at ultra-low temperatures. It's used to safeguard the genetic diversity of food crops for generations to come and try to restore what's been lost. Take the tomato. It's such a universal part of our lives that we take it for granted, but a long history of breeding and selection has shrunk much of its genetic diversity.
The cultivated tomatoes today really are not as diverse as people think. We've manipulated them to a point where there's really not a lot of diversity. There is actually resistance in wild species. So now we have a source of that resistance. We now have to find a method, and the methods are developing as we talk, to take that resistance from the wild species and incorporate it into the cultivated species. But the germplasm is still available in many of the seed banks found around the world.
A member of the Solanaceae family, wild tomatoes originated in the Andes region of South America. Wild tomato species are adapted to a wide range of habitats, but most have tiny, pea-sized fruits. Evidence suggests they spread to Mexico, where they were first domesticated and selected for larger fruit size. After arriving in Europe in the 16th century, tomatoes moved throughout Asia and eventually were cultivated in Africa, the Middle East, and North America. Over time, genetic diversity in tomatoes was lost. Plant geneticists and breeders have grown increasingly concerned about selecting for key traits like yield and harvestability, as well as stress tolerance and disease tolerance. Wild relatives of tomatoes have been the source of virtually all important genes for resistance to tomato diseases.
We find diseases all over the world, and we have certain diseases being in southern states like Florida, which is a big tomato state, and in California on the west coast. And the diseases that impact tomatoes in those two states are often very different. When you start making crosses between a cultivar, which is current, and a wild species, you're getting some traits which are not as desirable. So the plant breeder then has to try to work through that, keep the resistance, and yet still maintain the shape and the color that the market he's breeding for requires.
Tomatoes vary in size, shape, color, and flavor. Some varieties grow tall, and others develop as bushes on the ground that don't need to be supported by stakes. Tomato stems are covered in a soft hair that repels caterpillars and other insects while reflecting light, allowing the plant to retain moisture. Some wild species have especially dense layers of hair. The antioxidant-rich pigments that give tomatoes their range of vibrant colors are called carotenoids. The deeper the color, the more nutritious the fruit.
You can see the intensity of the color, which is very desirable, and it's driven to a certain extent by the market or the end use. So if I'm growing a fresh market tomato like this, oftentimes the market says it has to be round, has to be red, it has to be smooth. So the markets dictate the various traits that you want to look at. If you were to go to the farmer's market, you will find a lot more heirlooms tomatoes. And this is an heirloom, but you can see this shape looks entirely different than this shape. There's a lot of germplasm out there available for breeders to incorporate whatever they need on the final product.
Plant geneticists and breeders also prioritize traits for tomato plants' ripening times and harvest yields, and pay extra close attention to how varieties respond to differences in temperature and moisture levels as the world's climate changes.
The adaptability to a wide range of environments, which in many cases in cultivated tomatoes really doesn't exist, but you can take advantage of wild species to bring that over. The wild species offer a great deal of diversity that should be taken advantage of.
The plant genetic resources stored here carry within them knowledge from the past and hope for the future. This diversity will continue to shape our relationship with tomatoes and other crops, enabling us to create a more resilient food system.